there are all kinds of teeny tiny animals skittering and slithering around our planet. But have you ever stopped and wondered, what actually is the smallest animal on Earth? Let's find out on today's episode of
Colossal Questions.
In order to answer this question, we first need to decide on an answer for a much more basic question. What actually is an animal? Seems simple, right? Well, as it turns out, the answer actually gets a bit murky. Scientifically speaking, an animal is any living organism that's made up of multiple cells, eats organic material, breathes oxygen, can move, and can reproduce. Humans fit the bill. We're made up of trillions of different cells, but there are lots of things out there so small that they're made up of just a few cells clumped together. There are some living things out there that are made up of just one single cell, like bacteria. Well, that means they're not considered animals, but prokaryotes instead. That's just a fancy science way of saying they're a super basic single-celled organism. In fact, their cell doesn't even have a nucleus, which is what controls a cell. More complex cells, like animal cells, have a nucleus. Inside that nucleus is all the DNA that helps make us into something much more complex than a single cell. These types of organisms are called eukaryotes. Almost all living organisms you can see on Earth are eukaryotes, including plants and, yes, all animals. In 2011, the smallest known animal was discovered, a jellyfish called a myxobolus. They can be really small, like less than 9 micrometers long. That's around 1/1000th of an inch. Really tiny. Of course, this is just the smallest animal we currently know about. New discoveries are made all the time, so who knows? Before long, there could be an even smaller critter crawling around somewhere. Okay, so this little jellyfish might technically be the smallest animal we know about today, but it does beg the question, what's the smallest known animal you can actually see with the human eye? The answer to that question is found on the second largest island in the world, New Guinea. That's where scientists back in 2009 discovered the smallest known vertebrate in the world hopping around the jungle. A tiny little frog called Pedophrine amoensis. Cute! The average adult only grows to be about 8 millimeters long from end to end, which is only slightly bigger than the eraser on the back of your pencil. And there you have it. A seemingly simple question with a surprisingly complex answer. So for now, those microscopic little jellyfish will remain the smallest animal on Earth, and our little frog friend will continue to be the world's smallest known vertebrate. That is, until we find something smaller, of course. Over eons of time, there have been tons of titanic creatures who have walked the Earth, soared through the sky, and swam in the oceans. But have you ever stopped and wondered, what actually is the largest animal to ever exist? Let's find out on today's episode of
Colossal Questions.
Many of the biggest animals to ever exist lived hundreds of thousands or even millions of years ago. Take Gigantopithecus, for example. The largest ape to ever live was a distant relative of modern-day orangutans who stood somewhere between 8 and 10 feet tall. That's mighty big to us humans, but it pales in comparison to the biggest animals ever. The largest creature living on land today is the African elephant, which can weigh up to 7 tons, which is about the same as your average delivery truck. A full-grown African elephant can be up to 35 feet from trunk to tail and stand about 12 feet tall. Okay, that's the largest land animal on Earth today, but what's the biggest animal ever? Well, believe it or not, it's not a dinosaur or a woolly mammoth or any kind of colossal creature from the past. That's right. It turns out the largest animal ever is actually living today. But it doesn't live on land. It thrives deep in the ocean, quietly bigger than any massive meat eater who ever lived. It's the blue whale, and it's not even that close. Blue whales can be anywhere between 75 and 100 feet long when they're fully grown, and can weigh well over 100 tons. To put that into perspective, that's about as long as 3 school buses lined up, and heavier than a space shuttle. Their heart is about the size of a small car, and their arteries are big enough for a human to actually climb through. They're so big that a group of 50 people could stand together on a blue whale's tongue. Even baby blue whales are big. A newborn calf is about 25 feet long and already weighs more than an African elephant. This makes blue whales not just the biggest creature on Earth, but the biggest by a wide margin. You might imagine that the mighty dinosaurs who lived millions of years ago were bigger, but nope. Maybe the largest known dinosaur is the Argentinosaurus, which only weighed around 180,000 pounds, or about half the weight of a blue whale. It might seem surprising to us, but it actually makes a lot of sense that the world's biggest creatures live underwater rather than on land. Land animals have to be able to support all that weight, but sea creatures get some extra help from the water, which makes it easier to grow nice and, well,
colossal!
There's plenty of creatures on Earth that can do all kinds of damage, but who's the most dangerous of them all? Let's find out on today's episode of
Colossal Questions.
We have lots of good candidates for deadliest animal on Earth. Take elephants, for example. They're the largest land animals on Earth and can be fiercely aggressive if provoked. They have no problem trampling people or other animals, or even entire villages when they're angry. And if that wasn't destructive enough, elephants also have excellent memories, which means they might even hold a grudge if they're really wronged. Hippos are another of Earth's most aggressive animals. Even though they mostly eat plants, hippos are huge and more than willing to fight, even for no reason at all. And yet the deadliest animal of them all is also one of the smallest. Mosquitoes. These bothersome little bugs are so deadly because they can spread viruses from person to person when they suck your blood. Experts report that nearly 700 million people each year get a disease from a mosquito bite, which leads to somewhere between 2 and 3 million deaths. Malaria, dengue, and Zika are 3 of the many diseases that you can get from mosquito bites if you live in high-risk areas. But before you start building a bunker to hide in, there is some good news. Since the year 2000, medical advancements have led to an almost 40% drop in malaria deaths. And unless you live in certain areas, there's no real risk of getting a deadly disease. So next time you're on a safari, just keep a safe distance from the elephants and hippos and definitely wear bug spray. Every year, more and more animals are in serious danger of going extinct. But have you ever stopped and wondered, what causes animals to go extinct in the first place? Let's find out on today's episode of
Colossal Questions.
Of all the animals that have ever lived on Earth, 99.9% are now extinct. The first and most common way that animals go extinct is what we're going to call extinction by natural causes. This is when a species dies out naturally because of forces like climate change, competition from other animals, a reduced food supply, or most likely, a combination of all three. Most natural extinctions happen very slowly over hundreds or even thousands of years. But every once in a while, a catastrophic event can lead to a quick mass extinction, like the meteorite that killed the dinosaurs. Natural causes may have been the main reason animals went extinct throughout most of Earth's history, but over the last couple hundred years, humans have given nature a run for its money as the biggest cause of extinction. That's right, over the last 500 years or so, humans have hunted lots of animals into extinction. Take the passenger pigeon, for example. When European settlers first arrived in North America in the late 1400s, there were 3 to 5 billion passenger pigeons living there. By the 1800s, hunting and eating the poor pigeons was so widespread in the US that the very last passenger pigeon died in 1914. And that's just one example. Some species, like the American bison, are luckier. Millions of bison lived in North America until the Europeans arrived. Hunting was so intense that only 541 were left by 1889. Sound familiar? Well, unlike the passenger pigeon, this story has a happier ending. A handful of ranchers gathered the remaining bison together to save them from extinction. Since then, their numbers have flourished, and more than 300,000 bison live today on farms and national parks around the US and Canada. Animals are also hunted for body parts like fur, feathers, hides, or horns. And hunting isn't the only way humans cause animals to go extinct. Habitat loss is a huge problem too. When we build giant farms to grow food, the natural land that many animals rely on is destroyed, leading to their extinction. Pollution can poison the land, air, and especially water, and has at least 700 marine species on the brink of extinction right now. So just remember, like tigers, elephants, and rhinos, even the mightiest animals are at risk of extinction if we're not careful. Have you ever stopped to watch two animals interact with each other and wonder, can animals actually talk to each other? Let's find out on today's episode of
Colossal Questions.
Experts say that all languages from cultures all around the world are rooted in turn-taking. One person talks, then the other responds, back and forth. We just call that, well, talking. And it might seem basic, but it forms the foundation of all languages. And, believe it or not, most animals across the globe tend to turn-take with each other, too. There's still lots of research that needs to be done on how animals talk to each other, but experts are confident that animals definitely can communicate with each other. In fact, anyone who's spent time around a pet probably already knows this. Dogs and cats respond to commands or even specific words that they can understand. They can also talk back to you. Most pet owners can tell when their dog is hungry or tired or needs to pee or wants to play. All of that is your pet talking to you. All the different sounds that animals make are a form of language. Barks, meows, croaks, bleats, tweets, roars, and songs are all ways for those animals to communicate. According to experts, prairie dogs have one of the best vocabularies of any animal out there. They don't just use words or sounds to tell other prairie dogs that there's a looming threat. They can also use more expressive words that let the others know the size, shape, threat level, and oncoming speed of an approaching creature. In most cases, experts are still trying to understand what animals are saying to each other, but it's pretty clear that animals everywhere are always talking. So, do animals talk to each other? Absolutely! It just might be a while before we have any good idea what they're saying. What? Sorry guys. I was having a dream about my dog. Speaking of dreams, have you ever stopped and wondered what's going on in your furry friend's head while it sleeps? Do animals have dreams the same way humans do? Let's find out on today's episode of
Colossal Questions.
The hardest part about answering this question for scientists is that, well, pets can't tell us about their dreams. But basically everything we do know about whether or not animals dream comes from what we know about our own dreams. Each night, about an hour or two after you fall asleep, your eyeballs will start darting around behind your closed eyelids. This stage of your sleep cycle is called REM, or REM sleep, which stands for rapid eye movement. During this stage, your body is powered down, but your brain is as active as when you're awake. For humans, the REM stage is when dreaming begins. Many scientists have looked at the brain activity of sleeping animals to try and solve the mystery once and for all. What they found is that almost all mammals and birds have a REM stage when they sleep, and cold-blooded animals like reptiles, amphibians, and fish don't. But the research didn't stop there. Researchers at MIT put rats on a track and measured their brain activity while they moved towards food at the other end of the track. Once the same rats fell into the REM stage of sleep, they measured their brain again and saw identical patterns. This led scientists to believe that the rats were dreaming about running for food on the track. Many experts believe the same thing is true for dogs. Like rats, pups likely dream about their day-to-day lives and experiences. Pretty cool. Even cooler, the smaller the dog, the more it dreams. Small dogs can have dreams as often as every 10 minutes, while big dogs can have an hour or two between dreams. In another study, scientists measured the brain activity of singing birds. Once the birds fell asleep, the researchers measured again and, you guessed it, the brain activity was almost exactly the same. The experts still don't know for sure, but this has led many to believe that the birds are either dreaming about singing or they can hear their own song in their sleep. So, does your little pug muffin dream? Many experts think it's likely. So next time your dog starts running in place while it's sleeping, rest assured, she's probably dreaming about that great fuzzy tennis ball in the sky. That's a good boy, Mr. Sprinkles.